doing some more example questions of constraint relations and applications of Newton's laws. Though technically we have finished the chapter, but just few additional type of questions, and then we will take an introduction into friction today and start with that also. So let's start with some review questions. Newton's laws of motion. So the first example I want to start with is an interesting case of the application of wedge constraint as well as the concept of pseudo force in non-inertial frame. So let's understand this kind of thing. So in this example, what we have is a smooth inclined plane. Fixed inclined plane, of course. So this is just a guiding line. So this is a smooth and fixed inclined plane. Now we have a wedge that is shaped such that it's a triangular wedge whose top surface is horizontal and the side surface is similar angle, so it exactly fits in. So this which wedge is, let's say, E, and then on top of the wedge we have another block B sitting here like this, and this is also a smooth surface. So the triangular wedge A is released from rest with the block B placed on its horizontal surface. Given that mass of A is 4 times mass of B and theta is equal to 37 degrees, G is equal to 10 meters per second square, find the acceleration of the wedge A and the acceleration of the wedge, I mean the block B. These two quantities we have to find out. Okay, so just start with this question. Begin by making the appropriate free body diagrams and try to understand which reference frame you should solve in, constraint relation, if any, etc., things like that. Start with this, people. We'll do a couple of questions and then we'll move on to the introduction to friction today. Okay, that Just let me know whatever answer you're getting. Or if you first worked out the constraint relation or something, you can just drop that constraint relation also in the message box. I'll verify it for you. There'll be some kind of relation between the magnitude of the two accelerations. Okay, so you can first verify that also with me. I'm not exactly understanding. But Shubham, if you're giving in terms of ratio, yeah, then it's fine. Correct. Yeah, that's okay. That. But it will be 3/5, not 4/5. Because theta is 37. So there are a couple of ways of approaching this. Let's understand. So FBD of the wedge, obviously we should make in the ground frame. So in the inertial ground frame, this wedge is going to accelerate in this direction at like this. So we will take this as our y-axis and the direction of acceleration as our x-axis. Okay, and we will understand the forces acting on it are its own weight. Some sort of normal reaction that the upper block is applying on it. So that is N. And some sort of normal reaction that the inclined surface is applying on it. That is like this. Okay. end prime, let's say, and under the action of these forces, okay, all this happening. So this angle is theta, this angle is theta, okay. So if we make that point type of free body diagram, which we should, you can see that the forces, once again, this normal reaction, in the normal reaction that the block from above is applying, this one is n prime of course, and then the weight. And under the action of all these forces, taking y and x axis like this, so this angle is theta because this angle is theta and it has an acceleration along the inclined plane of this. All right, so we have the equation that n plus sine theta is mass into acceleration. Okay. And we have the equation that n prime balances cos theta. This equation will not be of that much use to us, so Kevin, what was the constraint relation that you got between the expressions? Okay, now as far as the block is concerned, we have an option. If we make the block's free body diagram in the ground frame, then also we have very decent way of solving the problem, because in that case there are only two forces acting on it which are both vertical. So it's very easy to understand that in the ground frame this one will have an acceleration which is vertical, does not have a horizontal component of acceleration. So with respect to ground, the absolute acceleration of this one should be vertically downwards. Okay. And we have the simply the equation, weight minus normal reaction is mass into acceleration. So this is our second equation. And our variables are the two accelerations and the normal reaction we have to eliminate. So we will need a third equation. So that's where the constraint relation will come in, because the other equation I've written for the wedge is not going to help. Okay. So this is one way of solving the problem. Now, where will the constraint relation come? It will come from this thing. Virtual power, or you can say virtual work, whatever. Okay. So if you look at the situation of the triangular wedge, and the block sitting on top of it, now you understand the pair of mutual force, the internal force for the system so called, is the normal reaction. So on the block it's acting upwards, on the wedge it's acting vertically downwards. Okay, so this normal reaction. Now, the point of application on the wedge where that force is acting, that is moving in which direction? It's moving along the inclined plane. So at some point of time, if it has an instantaneous velocity Va, okay, and at that point of time this block is coming down with an instantaneous velocity Vb. So you can see that we can apply the virtual power theorem. So in that, this angle is theta. So net power delivered by normal reaction should be zero. So power delivered by normal reaction on A plus power delivered by normal reaction on B should be zero. So on A, you can see the power delivered is NVA sine theta, and on B it is minus NVB. So VB is equal to VA sine theta. And differentiate this, theta is constant here, is the angle of the wedge that's not changing with time. So you get the constraint relation for acceleration very easily as acceleration of the block B is nothing but 3 by 5 times acceleration of the block A. This is our third equation. Okay, this is giving us, because theta is 37 degrees. Okay, so hope this is clear. So these are the three equations now that I'm going to employ to solve the problem. Okay, this one, and this one. Okay, and then we have taken the ratio of the masses as 4:1. So we can, what we can do is, in the first equation, substitute MA as 4m and MB as m. So let So our equation 1 will become 4mg plus n sine 37 is 4m into acceleration of E. Second equation will become mg minus n is equal to mab. So we have this equation. So what we do is you can just multiply this equation with 5 by 3. So you have 4mg plus n is 20 by 3 m into acceleration of A, and this equation is mg minus n is equal to m into acceleration of B. Now add these two equations, this and this. So you have 5mg is equal to 20 by 3 acceleration of A plus acceleration of B times m. And now you substitute this relation. So 5mg becomes, now acceleration of A you can write as 5 by 3 times acceleration of B. So acceleration of B should become 45 upon 109 g, and acceleration of A will become 5/3 into 45/109, so that become like this. No, they are not stuck together, na Mahek. They are slipping between them. There is no friction, so there is no reason for them to accelerate together. This is the point you have to understand. Okay. So how we know that that is the case is, first of all, there is no friction, so they will slip. Now, the evidence for what I have done with this method is in the free body diagram. So that's what you have to understand here. That, actually, this is the constraint relation. So this is a different thing. Yeah, so in this you can see that the forces on B are vertical only. Okay, so motion of B is vertical only. This is in itself, this is a constraint in the problem. It's a constraint situation that the block B cannot have a horizontal displacement, and like that the wedge has to move along the incline because it is supported by the incline. So that's another constraint. Okay, so I'll just give you a minute to go through this. Yeah, mass of A is equal to 4 times mass of B. Oh, I might have interchanged that by mistake, A and B. Just a minute, I will. Okay. But the equations are correct. Okay, just that I've interchanged A and B by mistake. So let mass of B is equal to M. So mass of A will become 4M. Okay. And rest of the things are okay. Block B will not have a diagonal acceleration, Somarup. You understood why, no? I've explained that now. Okay. Okay, so I'll just give you some time to go through the free body diagrams from the beginning. Then I'll tell you another method to analyze B's motion also, and that is the non-inertial frame method. But in this method, what I've done is both the free body diagrams, A and B's FBDs, are done in ground frame. Okay, so both the FBDs here are in ground frame. So first concentrate on the FBD part. Okay, then you can see the constraint relation. I'll just minimize this a little more so that you can see both the FBDs first. Don't worry about the calculation part, that will come in the end. First, just concentrate on the two free body diagrams and the equations. Then next thing we'll discuss about is again the constraint relation, which will come from virtual power. And then finally, you can concentrate on this solving part. So how do I know that the block B, when I look from the ground frame, has to come down only vertically? Because I know there is no horizontal force on it. Okay. So if you just imagine what the guy on the ground is seeing as the situation over here, it's very interesting. You will realize that for the observer on the ground, okay, let's say this is the system to begin with. Okay, the guy who's stationary on the ground, he's seeing block A like this and block B sitting on top of it like this. Now after some time he will see that block A has slid down the inclined plane and come somewhere here. Okay. But the block B has only come down vertically. You will see that. Okay. That is what this is telling us. Okay. Just draw that more properly and you'll understand. So after some time in his frame, the wedge A has slid and come here. But while that has happened, the block B has only moved vertically down like this. So you can see that A has had a motion along the inclined plane, displacement along the inclined plane, but B has only got a vertical displacement of SB. Okay. And you can also show from geometry also here. From geometry, you will be able to show that SB will be equal to 3 by 5 times SA. That's yet another way of understanding the this thing, constraint relation. To understand something like this happens, okay. So this is SB, sorry, SA, and this is SB, and this angle is theta. So geometrically also you can understand this constraint, which I have shown you by virtual power, much easier way of understanding the constraint, but you can understand it geometrically also. So it is a wedge constraint after all. It is to do with the fact that, you know, the wedges are this is the initial state of our system. Yeah. Now after some time, the wedge is sliding down to this position. And by then the block has come here. So you can see that this downward displacement of the block is the same as this. And so in this diagram, this is the displacement of, sorry, the wedge A. This is the displacement of the wedge, and this is the displacement of the block B, and this angle is theta, and so we have this constraint relation. But how we know the block is only coming down vertically? We know that because of this note over here, this, that only vertical forces are acting on it, so the displacement has to be only vertical. There's nothing to move the block horizontally. No, what will happen is block B will hit the inclined plane at some stage. No? As the block A keeps shifting, the block B will hit the inclined plane and lose contact with A. Yeah, it will lose contact with A, but by then it's already come in contact with the inclined plane. So that you can see in this diagram, the second one that I've drawn. Now, if you keep shifting A, you'll see at some stage the vertical line along which B is hit going, it will hit the inclined plane and it would have lost contact with A by then. Okay, so rather than, you know, draw such a complicated geometrical shape and work out the trigonometry and all that, what we prefer for the constraint relation is the method below here, the virtual power theorem application, this one. Now this is my constraint relation. My virtual power method. And then the rest is solving. So people, hope it is clear up to the equations part for all of you. Okay, Aman, yeah, man, that's clear. Okay, good, Snikita. Kevin, is clear to you also? Okay, good. Now, just the solving part, it's little lengthy, but just you can go through it again also. But before that, before we do the whole solving, go through the solving thing in detail, I'll solve the question in another method where we'll keep the wedge free body diagram the same, but we will do the blocks free body diagram in something more intuitive than this. That is with respect to the wedge. Imagine you are standing on the wedge A and you are seeing the block A move. So then it's very interesting. How do you think the motion of block A will look in the frame of the wedge? Just try to visualize this before we come to the solution. Think and tell me that alternately, if the block B is being viewed assume we are seeing it oh sorry atrocious spelling yeah is being viewed from the wedge A's frame. Okay, how does it motion? How does its motion look like? Yeah, you'll realize very interesting. It will move towards the right, correct, in the horizontal motion. Very good. Okay. So now you think how, what force is going to give it the horizontal motion? Okay. So realize that if you're sitting on the block, on the wedge, then to you the story is very different. It looks like the block is moving horizontally towards your right all the time. Okay. If you are part of the wedge's frame, then to you the block will look like it's going from here along this sort of direction. Move like this. It'll have an acceleration. This is the acceleration of B relative to A. So that's why I've written it as an AR. It's a relative acceleration. So what you'll do in this case is you'll understand pseudo force, because you are in a frame that is going in that sort of diagonal manner. So what force is giving this the horizontal acceleration? It's pseudo force. So what you do is you make the wedges frame in the ground frame, wedges FBD in ground frame, like we've done before. Okay. So all that is fine. You can see that the wedge is coming down the inclined plane with some acceleration AA like this because of all the forces acting on it. And equations are same as we had seen earlier. Okay, so the important equation here is that mg for A plus normal reaction whole thing sine component is equal to mass of A into acceleration of A. That equation is the same, nothing changes there. Okay, but now you make the blocks FBD. So this is an inertial frame. Okay. Now you look at the Bloch's free body diagram in the non-inertial frame of wedge A. This is where it gets very interesting. So now you are standing on that wedge. So as the observer, you are having an acceleration in this sort of direction. As the observer, your acceleration is along that 37 degree angle to the horizontal, like this. This is the acceleration of E. Okay. And it is at an angle of theta, like this. So in your frame now, when you understand the situation of the wedge, you'll realize, the block B, you'll realize the forces acting on it. First and foremost, there is a force which is acting in this sort of manner. As a pseudo force, this is your pseudo force. Okay, which will act at 37 to the horizontal. And then of course there is the block's own weight and all that. So this is the block B's own weight, and then there's a normal reaction acting upwards on it. And these forces together in this frame are ensuring that the block only has a horizontal relative acceleration. So the relative acceleration of the block, not the acceleration in ground frame, but the relative acceleration of the block, that one is along the horizontal direction. So this is the relative acceleration. And this angle is your theta. So what are the equations we'll get here? We'll get that N plus pseudo force sine component balances weight. This will become our second equation. And pseudo force is horizontal component gives you the relative acceleration, which is horizontal. So now this is our cluster of equations. So now you see we don't need a constraint relation. The constraint has been taken care of here. The fact that the relative acceleration is horizontal, that itself is the constraint. Now that the surface of contact is horizontal, so unka relative acceleration kaisa hoga, horizontal hoga, that itself is taking care of the constraint. So that's why we don't need any other equation, because we've already taken that constraint into account here. Okay, so now what we'll do is we'll write this one as 4mg plus n into 3 by 5 is equal to 4m into acceleration of A. And so this becomes 4mg plus n is equal to 20 by 3 m into acceleration of A. This equation is that n plus 3 by 5 m into acceleration of A is equal to mg. And this equation is that m into acceleration of A into cos theta, that is 4 by 5, is equal to m into relative acceleration. So let's solve this system now. So between these two equations, this is only my equation 1, this is my equation 2, my third one. So between equation 1 and 2, we'll solve for acceleration of A. Very easy. What we can do is, see, we can write this one 4mg plus n is equal to 20 by 3 m into acceleration of u, and this one just take the n on that side, so this becomes mg minus n is equal to 3 by 5 into m into acceleration of u. Now add the two equations, so n gets cancelled out. 5mg is becoming 20 by 3 plus 3 by 5. So see, you're getting that term which you should have expected. सो 5G इज इक्वल टू 100 प्लस 9, 109 बाई 15 एक्सलेशन ऑफ ए. सो वी आर डायरेक्टली गेटिंग एक्सलेशन ऑफ ए इज 75 बाई 109 जी, इज द सेम वैल्यू रिमेंबर वी गॉट अबव ऑल्सो. एंड देन सब्सटीट्यूट दिस इन द थर्ड इक्वेशन. सो रिलेटिव एक्सलेशन इज 4/5 ma, which you'll remember is also the constraint relation. You know, the horizontal component has to become like this. So the relative acceleration is 60/109 times g. Now from this we will get the ground frame acceleration also. But that for that we'll have to incorporate our this thing, kinematics. Okay. So now we'll understand that in a coordinate frame like this, where I'm taking this as y-axis and this as x-axis, okay, what is happening is that the acceleration of the block A is a vector which is like this. Block A's absolute acceleration is a vector like this, which is at 37 degrees. So acceleration of block A I can write as 75/109 g into minus 4/5 I cap cos 37, so minus 4/5 I cap minus 3/5 j cap. So this will become minus of g by 109, I can take common, and I'll have 60 I cap plus 45 j cap. I'll have this as the acceleration of E as a vector. Okay. Then the acceleration of B relative to this one, this relative acceleration of B relative to E, that is what this is. So that quantity is 60 by 109 g I cap. So now combine the two things, and what we learn about the acceleration of B in the ground frame will be acceleration of B relative to A plus acceleration of A. And this is the reverse of this equation, that relative acceleration of something is acceleration of that object minus acceleration of the reference frame. So reverse of this equation, now this becomes this. So acceleration of this in the ground frame is the relative acceleration plus acceleration. This is relative acceleration of B with respect to A. So that becomes like this. So just add these two vectors. So you see your 60/109 term is cancelling out, and you're getting the acceleration of B in the ground frame as minus 45/109 g j cap. So your conclusion is the same what we had got earlier. Your conclusion at the end of the day here is that acceleration of A is 75/109 g along the inclined plane, that is down the incline, and acceleration of B is 45/109 g vertically downwards. Okay. So the thing is, it's not that, you know, there is no constraint relation here. There is a constraint relation here also, but that is incorporated in the relative motion part. The moment we have understood that, okay, with respect to the wedge, the block is moving horizontally, we have taken it into account that the contact surface is a horizontal surface. So that has, you know, taken care of that geometry. The constraint is the geometry only here, no? That the contact surface is horizontal. So that has been taken care of by that equation. Okay. So I'll just zoom out a bit, but we'll have to go through this part by part. Okay, don't worry that this is a very lengthy question and all that. At this stage, this is not, you know, a type of question you are looking to solve in a minute or something. Okay, it is for your deeper understanding of, you know, all these things, not just Newton's laws, but relative motion, you know, constraint relation, so many things. So few good subjective questions like this will also help you improve your overall understanding of mechanics. It's not just about how much you are scoring at the JEE type of papers, but so just go through this part by part. I'll take you through it. Okay. Let me know if there's any doubt in any part. So the answer to this thing, it will look like B moves, or you can say slides, okay, horizontally towards the right. Okay, and this self is the geometrical constraint. So the moment we have taken that into account, we have actually developed the constraint. Okay, so once you understood this geometrical constraint, next thing, just concentrate on the two free body diagrams. The first one is the same we had seen above, wedge in the ground frame. But now this one is a more important one for us, this one. The blocks FBD in the non-inertial frame. Okay, and then the equations. Again, don't worry about solving of the equations, that you can go through later. Just see how we are getting equation 1, 2 and 3. And then I'll show you that the solving of this is giving the same answers in the end that we had got from the solving of the equations directly in the ground frame for both of them. Okay, so here this is relative to E, which is horizontal towards the right hand side. Okay, then once you have done the solving, as I said, don't worry about the calculation part of the solving, you can look at that later. It's just that these three equations which you are getting from the FBDs, you solved this and you have found out acceleration of A is this much, relative acceleration is this much. Now from this, how will we generate the acceleration of B in the ground frame? So that is where your kinematics again comes in. In your kinematics, you are making use of this concept here, that if the relative acceleration of B with respect to A is acceleration of B minus acceleration of A, then the ground frame acceleration of B will become what? It will become the sum of the relative velocity, the relative acceleration plus the acceleration of A. Okay. So further in terms of vectors, you'll see here that the acceleration of B relative to A is actually this kind of a acceleration. This is the acceleration of B relative to A. And this was having a magnitude of 60 by 109 G. This one is having a magnitude of 75 by 109 G. So when you actually add these two, you are getting the absolute acceleration of B in the ground frame, which is that very interesting vector downwards. So the absolute acceleration of this guy B is actually the vector sum of these two. which is working out to be vertically downwards. This is the acceleration of B with respect to ground, and that's 45 by 109 g. So that is that set of vectors that you are getting, this relation. So you can see satisfied by these vectors. Okay, and like I told you that if you just compare these results to what we had got by solving the equations earlier, see, solving of these equations also gave us the same result. This is vertically downwards, this is along the incline. Okay. Okay, so a bit of a massive question, but interesting question to understand various things, geometrical constraints, bit of pseudo force application also, wedge constraint, virtual power, everything is there in this question. Okay, now we'll move on to another example. Just a moment. So we have this kind of a situation now. And all these pulleys and things. All surfaces are frictionless in this case. Okay. So all surfaces are smooth. Okay. And mass of wedge A is 5 times mass of the block B. So if the system is released from rest with the thread dot, such that A and B have accelerations okay, then first thing find this ratio okay, and secondly find the magnitude of this one's acceleration. Just try this out, people. See, Meg and Kevin, what you have to understand is that you have to calculate the acceleration of B in the ground frame, not the relative acceleration. If you're talking about the relative acceleration, yes, acceleration of B relative to A is twice of this thing. Okay. So what you have to understand here is that at any point of time, if E is having a velocity like this and therefore an acceleration in this direction, then B's relative velocity and relative acceleration is in the downward direction. The ground frame thing is quite different. Okay, the ground frame thing for B is in this sort of diagonal direction. So acceleration of B relative to A and velocity of B relative to A is in the downward direction. Okay. So this AR is basically magnitude of acceleration of B relative to A, and VR is this. So what is actually happening is that if the acceleration of velocity whatever of A in the ground frame is like this, then B's acceleration will be like this. This is the acceleration of A in the ground frame along the x-axis. Okay, then the acceleration of B with respect to A in the ground frame will actually have a magnitude like this. So the relative acceleration that we're talking about, that one will be the vertical vector. This will be like this. Is the difference of these two? The difference of these two is this. You can even draw it this side so that you have more clarity. This is the vector difference of AB minus AA. So this is your, which is acceleration of B minus acceleration of A. So this is the thing. This has to be vertical. So now when we look at this thing, virtual power method, it's a little bit more complicated, okay, but not that difficult to handle at the end of the day. So if you look at the wedge B or whatever, the wedge E, on E there's a lot of tension acting. There's a combination of two horizontal tensions and one vertical tension acting like this. But E's own velocity at any instant is horizontal. So power delivered by tension on E is plus 2t Va. Whereas if you look at the block B at any instant is having a velocity in this sort of direction. This is the velocity of B in the ground frame, but it is the vector sum of a VR like this and a VA like this. Okay. So this velocity of B is velocity of B with respect to A plus velocity of A. So it is a minus VR J cap plus a VA I cap, just like we had written for the acceleration. And on the block B, there's only one tension acting, and that tension is acting vertically upwards, like this. Okay. So when you take this dot product, you will see that the power delivered by tension on B is just minus T VR. Because this component of velocity is perpendicular to the tension, so it's not delivering any power. And this component is at 180 degrees, so it's this position. So that's how your virtual power thing now comes in. So net power delivered by tension should be 0. So plus 2TVA minus TVR should be 0. So this relative velocity is twice of VA. So the relative acceleration is 2 times the acceleration of VA. So now you can see that acceleration of V in the ground frame is some this. The acceleration of B in the ground frame is this minus ARJ cap. So that is nothing but 2 times AJ cap. Substitute this now. So you can see that the magnitude of B's acceleration is square root of A square plus 2 times A square. So it is root 5 times acceleration. Okay. So the correct answer to this thing is going to be 1:√5. Okay. Because what is happening is that this thing is 1:2. Okay. And acceleration of B, that's why it's root 5 times the acceleration. So the correct answer is 1:√5. Okay. So again, something you have to be very careful about. You are tempted to give the answer is 1:2. And then the rest of the things can come from free body diagram. So when you do the FVDs, make the FVD of B in the non-inertial frame. So you will be using these values only. A relative, which is twice of A. So the equations are then quite simple. But this ratio part is something tricky. Most people would make the mistake of saying it's 1:2. But remember, when we are just talking about magnitude of B's acceleration, we mean that by default, we are talking about magnitude of B's acceleration in the ground frame and not in the non-inertial frame. So that's something you have to be extra careful about. Okay, so now coming back to your free body diagrams, rest of it is pretty simple. So you make the wedge A's free body diagram in the inertial frame. Okay, so tension, and there will be some kind of normal force that this one is applying. So these are the horizontal forces. Apart from that, of course, there is more vertical forces. Okay. But we are interested only in the horizontal part. So equation becomes 2t minus n is equal to mass of A into acceleration of A. This is your, let's say, your first equation. Then you make the blocks FBD in the non-inertial frame of the wedge. So that is having an acceleration in this direction. So there's a pseudo force on it, which is like this. And that is what generates this normal reaction. Jiska ki equal and opposite reaction is that one. In its own weight, then this tension T, and then it is having this downward acceleration in this frame, which is A relative, which is twice of T. So in fact, that A relative was twice of A. That was in fact our first equation, which we got as the constraint before. So this is our second equation now. Okay. Now N is balancing the pseudo force. Okay. So that is our third equation. Okay. And weight minus tension is equal to mass of B into acceleration of B. That's our fourth equation. Now you start substituting the conditions. Okay, so given to us that mass of A was 5 times mass of B. So you take mass of B as m, mass of A becomes 5m. So this equation becomes 2t minus n is equal to 5m into acceleration of E. This equation becomes n is equal to m into acceleration of E. Okay, and this equation becomes mg minus p is equal to mass into 2 times acceleration of E. Okay, so first you substitute this here. So this gives us the equation that 2t is equal to 6 times this, or t is equal to 3 times. Oh, sorry, something has gone wrong here. Yeah, then you substitute this here. So next step, you substitute this in this equation. So you get acceleration of A as g by 5. Okay, so you will get acceleration of B relative to A as 2g by 5 downwards. Okay, this is horizontal like this. So you will get acceleration of B in the ground frame to be g by 5 I cap minus 2g by 5 j cap, and its value will be g by root 5. Whereas acceleration of E in the ground frame is g by 5 I cap. So these are your vector answers, these are your magnitude wise answers. This is in sort of this sort of direction. Okay, and just go over my solving part once more. So this is our equation 2, this is our equation 3, and this is our equation 4, and we've already used equation 1 in that. Yes, this is from equation 1. Constraint relations, Nikita, is coming from virtual power. Okay, so I'll just take you above once more. So power delivered by a force is basically what? It is dot product of force and velocity. So you can see here that for the block A, what is happening is that the velocity at any instant is in this direction. Okay, and what about tension? There are two tensions acting horizontally. So 2t horizontally, and there's one tension acting vertically. So power is force dot velocity. So these two tensions are delivering plus 2t Va, and the vertical tension is delivering zero. So the power delivered is plus 2 Va. Is it clear, Nikita, this one? Okay, now similarly, you look at the situation for block B. So for block B, you can see it's here. For block B, the velocity of B is in this sort of direction in the ground frame. So it has a horizontal component of Va and a vertical component of some V relative, which we're trying to calculate. But what about the tension acting on it? There's a single tension acting vertically upwards. Now, so when you take dot product of this, no? You take this T dot VB. When you break the velocity into the two components, you can see this component is perpendicular, so it will not deliver any power. Whereas this component is at 180. So you'll see it will become minus T into VR. इज इट क्लियर बेटा नाउ? ठीक ही था? ओके गुड. सो इट इज लिटिल बिट ट्रिकी. अच्छा यू कैन ऑल्सो डू बाई थ्रेड लेंथ. यू कैन ऑल्सो अंडरस्टैंड दिस वे दैट यू नो बाई द टाइम दिस वेज मूव्स, इफ इट मूव्स थ्रू अ डिस्टेंस एक्स इन दिस डायरेक्शन, इट विल रिलीज 2x अमाउंट ऑफ थ्रेड. So that means this must be going down by how much? It must be going down by 2x. So the relative displacement should be twice of this horizontal displacement. So the relative downward displacement should be twice of the horizontal displacement. That you can understand by thread length also, because after all it's just a simple system of couple of pulleys. And one thread. There aren't multiple threads with a lot of pulleys. So we can also understand this by thread length concept. So if this question is clear, all the parts to everyone now. Okay, good. And Kevin, you have got the answer already, I think earlier. You know, the horizontal acceleration of A is g by 5. Okay, good. Chalo, now let's move on to a bit of introduction to do with friction. So friction is the second type of contact force. So what type of force is friction? Friction is a contact force that acts between two surfaces. Two surfaces. Now, very important, tangentially. So, what does tangentially mean? Along the plane of the surface, of the contact surface. Such that it opposes slipping or tendency to slip between the two surfaces. So it opposes slipping in the situation where there is actually no slipping. There is actually relative motion. So then this becomes actually the surface is are slipping with respect to each other. So in that case, the type of friction that acts, it opposes the slipping. Whereas in the second case, where it's opposing a tendency to slip, okay, actually the surfaces are at rest with respect to each other. Okay. But there would have been slipping unless friction were able to prevent it. So this is the type of friction that acts when there is actually the two surfaces are not moving with respect to each other. They are at rest with respect to each other, but there's a tendency to slip, and that tendency for slipping is being managed by friction, or is being prevented by friction. So let's understand with this, with a couple of examples. So suppose we are seeing a situation where there is a horizontal surface on which we have placed a block Now the mass of the block is known to us to be, suppose, 10 kilograms.
Okay.
And we are trying to push it with an external force. We are trying to push it with an external force, which is Newtons. But as a result of this pushing, we are observing that the block is accelerating. Okay. Under the action of this force, the block accelerates at the rate of only 1.5 meters per second square. So then what is the conclusion that we can come to? The conclusion here is that since E is less than F by M, because F by M would have been 2 meters per second square. E is less than 2 meters per second square. That means, it implies that there is some friction. There is some frictional force at the surface, which is opposing the slipping. The block is slipping on the surface because it is moving, but there must be some additional force. Okay, so how we realize this, we understand this, that when we think of the free body diagram of the block, immediately it becomes clear to us that there must be some other type of force present. And that other type of force is not a normal reaction, because it has to act horizontally. It has to oppose this external force F. So when we visualize the free body diagram, we understand that on the block, along with this external force that we are applying, there must be another force which is acting horizontally opposite to it. Otherwise, it would not be possible that its acceleration is only 1.5 meters per second square. Whereas the force we are applying is of 2 newtons. So that means there must be another force present which is acting at the surface of the block in contact with the ground. Yes, the ground is trying to, with the friction on the ground, is trying to do this. So there must be some friction present like this which is doing the job. So we have F minus friction is equal to mass into acceleration. So we have applied the force of 20 newtons, but there is some force trying to retard the motion. So we can see that there is a friction of 5 newtons. Okay, I can see what type of force this friction is. It acts along the surface. So it is a contact force acting at the contact surface, that is the floor, tangential to it. That is horizontally. Okay. And opposing the direction of slipping. That's why the friction is acting backwards. So this is not only it's called friction, but it is called kinetic friction, because it's acting between two surfaces which are slipping with respect to each other. Okay. Of course, in addition to this, there is weight of the block and normal reaction. So of course, there is normal reaction N, which balances the weight of the block. Okay. But this is a normal contact force. Okay. So this is a different type of contact force compared to friction, which is a tangential type of contact force. And what the friction is doing in this case, it is opposing the slipping. If friction had not been present, it would have slipped faster at an acceleration of 2 meters per second square. but here it is accelerating somewhat slower at 1.5, so it is able to oppose the slipping to a certain extent. It's not able to prevent the slipping, but it's opposing. So that is one type of friction, and that type of friction is called kinetic friction. Okay, so just make a note of this example and hope this is clear to all of you. Yes, Jaiwal. So, you know, there are two kinds of possibilities of friction. Now, in this example, we are talking about the, you know, the first of the two possibilities I was telling you about, that it is trying to stop, but it's not able to stop. Okay. Whereas, you know, if we were to reduce the amount of external force, instead of 20 newtons, we are applying a much lesser force of, let's say, 2 newtons or 3 newtons or something like that, we might observe that the object is prevented from moving altogether. There is no slipping actually, because friction is able to completely oppose the slipping and prevent it from happening. Here it is opposing it, but it's not preventing it. It's only reducing the amount of relative acceleration. So accordingly, there are two types of frictions. One is called static friction and one is called kinetic friction. So in this example, I've given you an introduction to what is the situation of kinetic friction. Okay, so in conclusion, we can say one more thing here, that whenever that we are observing that there is some friction acting tangentially, but it is only opposing the slipping, it is not able to prevent the slipping, then we say that that type of friction is in the category of kinetic friction. So kinetic friction is the type of friction, or you can say tangential contact force, that acts between two surfaces, slipping with respect to each other. So this kinetic friction opposes slipping. Okay. But it is not able to prevent it. So this is one category. Okay. Now another category could be where we are able to see that because of friction present, a situation in which otherwise they would have been slipping, there is actually now no slipping because the surface in concern is having friction, and the friction present is able to prevent the slipping from occurring. So suppose we have a situation like this now, where we have a 30 degree inclined plane, okay. And on that 30 degree inclined plane we are having a block, but interestingly that block is at rest. When we release it, that block is not observed to slip down the inclined plane. So this is a rough surface as opposed to a smooth surface, and this is a block of mass 10 kilograms, and take g's value also to be 10 meters per second square, okay. So now it is observed that if the block is observed to remain at rest, okay, or what is called static equilibrium, that means at equilibrium in rest, when released on the rough inclined plane, okay, so this is what we are observing. So now based on this observation, we have to conclude something about the forces acting on it. So first thing, what type of friction acts between the inclined surface and the block? The answer to that is it's static friction. Okay. And second, make an FBD of the block to show the magnitude and direction. Of friction on the block. Okay. So the answer to the first part is very simple. We are observing that the block is remaining at rest. So obviously it is static friction. Okay. The type of friction acting, the friction acting here is static friction. Static friction is the type of friction that acts between two surfaces that have a tendency to slip. Okay. But obviously, friction is successful in preventing slipping, keeping the two surfaces at rest. So in that situation, the type of friction that acts, that is called static friction. Okay. And always it will act tangentially. Okay. And opposing the tendency to slip. Okay, so here when we visualize the free body diagram, it becomes very easy to understand how this is exactly happening. We can see that in the free body diagram situation, so what we'll do is we'll draw the mg in an already resolved manner. There's a component of mg along the inclined plane, which is your mg sine theta component. Whereas the component normal to the inclined plane. This is your mg cos theta. We've resolved it in the two. So this component, the one normal to the inclined plane, this is getting taken care of by normal reaction. Okay, so there's nothing here which is causing any tendency to slip. The normal reaction that is acting, normal reaction balances mg cos theta. So neither of these two forces are causing any tendency to slip, but mg sin theta, it is the component of weight that makes the block tend to slip down the incline. But since its acceleration is zero, so there is some force which is there, which is now cancelling that. It's able to prevent the slipping. So that force on the block is this one, that's friction. So this is now static friction. So this is getting, you can say, neutralized or balanced by static friction. So the magnitude of static friction will be equal to mg sin theta, which is, so there'll be a static frictional force of 50 newtons. Okay. And lag up the incline tangentially. Because the tendency of slipping is down the incline tangentially. So to prevent that tendency of slipping, the ground or the inclined plane is applying what type of a force on the block opposing that tendency to slip? So this is an example of static friction. Is the type of friction which acts when the slipping tendency is cancelled by friction. Okay. So it acts between two surfaces which are not slipping with respect to each other. Okay. But I think you'll struggle to view this in this kind of, okay. can we say that static friction is equal to the component of force causing the tendency to slip? But हाँ मतलब कॉम्पोनेंट ऑफ फोर्स और वॉट एवर एक्सटर्नल फोर्स एक्सेट्रा यू कैन से वॉट एवर फोर्स अदर देन फ्रिक्शन या जेवल दैट्स करेक्ट सो वॉट एवर फोर्स और कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ फोर्स अदर देन फ्रिक्शन इज एक्टिंग विच इज टेंडिंग टू मेक द ब्लॉक एक्सीलरेट ऑन द सर्फेस ना स्टैटिक फ्रिक्शन विल बैलेंस दैट वेर इज काइनेटिक फ्रिक्शन विल ऑलवेज बी लेस देन दैट But yes, the thing I'm saying about kinetic friction is a little bit conditional. So I'll come back to that. But about static friction, what you can say is 100% correct. So let's understand more about this. Okay. So now if we come back to our original example where we have a block which is on a horizontal surface. And suppose we are doing like an experiment here where we are observing the situation of the block for various different amount of forces. The block is initially at rest. Okay. And now what we are doing is we are trying to drive it with an external force F. Now let us say the first time we apply a force of 5 newtons. And we see that the block remains at rest. The next time we apply a force of 6 newtons, we see the block still remains at rest. Okay. Then we bump up the force further, let us say 7 newtons, the block still remains at rest. Okay. Then we increase the force to let us say 8 newtons. Now we see the block just about tends to start moving very slowly. So its acceleration is tending to zero, but it starts to tend, it tends to start moving. Okay. And then by the time we've increased the force to 9 newtons, we see that the block accelerates. Okay, so suppose the mass of this block is, let us say, some 2 kgs or something. Now the block accelerates at A, which is more or less 0.5 meters per second square. So what is the conclusion? So suppose this is some experiment. Okay, so suppose these are observations from an experiment. Okay. Assuming these are the okay. So what is our conclusion? The conclusion is that when we applied a force of 5 newtons, the ground was able to apply a static friction of how much? 5 newtons, no? Because the acceleration is zero. By the time we increased our force to even 7 newtons or 6 newtons or whatever, the friction was still 7 newtons or 6 newtons or 5 newtons or whatever, depending on how much force we applied. But the moment we applied a force of 9 newtons, you can see the friction is not able to increase to that. This has now become kinetic friction because this is moving. There's a relative acceleration of 0.5, and the fact that there's a relative acceleration of 0.5 is showing us that how much is the friction? It's 8 newtons, because the net force must be 1, because the mass of the block is 2 kg. So I know the friction must be this. So what I'm observing from this, the conclusion from this observation is that static friction can adjust itself according to external force. Okay, and prevent slipping, but only up to a limit. Up to a certain limit, or this is called the limiting value of static friction. Okay, and in the previous example, okay, that maximum limiting value of static friction was equal to 8 newtons. Okay, this was the limiting value. So therefore, if F was less than equal to 8 newtons, the acceleration of the block was zero. The block remains at rest. Okay, but the moment F becomes greater than 8 newtons, now friction cannot prevent slipping. Because it cannot increase beyond that limiting value. So slipping starts, and the type of friction acting we say is kinetic friction. So the moment the external force becomes greater than 8 newtons, we can say the block starts to slip. Okay, and the friction acting now, it becomes kinetic friction. Okay, so we'll gradually understand more about the properties. Yeah, it's not so much, there's no bond breaking really that acts. Okay, the friction actually acts because of the roughness of the surface, so it's very much a mechanical force. So basically what happens is that if an object is on a so-called rough surface, it means that if you put the surface under the microscope, the object's surface is like this and the ground below it is also something like this. So that is why the moment there's a tendency for them to move relative to each other, there are forces in various sort of directions that act, which prevent that slipping. Okay, if there is actually some glue between the two of them and there's some kind of adhesive force, then that type of force is not called friction, it is called adhesive force. Adhesive force can happen because you put some material over there, like some kind of chemical glue, which is creating some bonding between the two surfaces. But then that is called adhesive force, that is not called frictional force. Friction is a mechanical force, which is basically a contact force that acts between rough surfaces. Rough surface means that, you know, the surface of contact is not perfectly plane. So that's why, okay. So there's good sort of theoretical description of this in Resnick-Halliday, and you can go through that. That will also help you. But now coming back to this, now the important thing that we will talk about as the main content of our next lecture will be that the limiting value of static friction which we can call F max, that is a maximum friction. This is a quantity, this depends on two things. Okay. The limiting value of static friction वहाँ पे 8 newtons था, so yeah, I'll show it to you. What does that depend on? So that depends on two factors. It depends on one, the normal contact force. Between the two surfaces, the more the amount of normal reaction, the better the friction will be. Okay. And the second is the material of the surface, both the surfaces, whether it is, you know, wood and wood, or wood against stone, okay, or marble against, you know, let's say granite, or granite against granite, or glass against stone, or some kind of metallic surface, all that will affect the value of maximum friction. So what we will see later is that the maximum friction is given by a relation called coefficient of friction into normal reaction. So here n is the normal reaction. Okay, and nu is the coefficient of friction. Okay, and this is a material property, so we'll discuss more about that in the next lecture and coming up. Okay, so this is also a good time if to you know start with some theory reading about friction if you have the time available away from your exams and all that. Okay, you can do some theory reading about friction from Resnick Halliday. About friction, okay, then static versus kinetic friction, okay, then the concept of coefficient of friction, etc. So do this theory reading from either Resnick Halliday, that will be the best place, whichever version of Resnick Halliday you have. Or you can do it from NCRT if Resnick Halliday is not available for you, or you can do it even from HCV, but in HCV it's very short. Okay, so it's better to go with either Halliday, Resnick, or even NCRT. Okay, and we'll discuss in detail about it more in the next lecture. Okay, meanwhile I will also send you a set of problems for extra practice in Newton's laws of motion, and also hope you are working out the module exercises. Okay, so next time we have a doubt session, etc., we will discuss Newton's laws of motion questions from the module exercises. Okay, also. Okay, so that's it for today's class, people. Thanks for attending, and I will send you the notes and the recording. Please go through the first couple of questions we did very carefully because they were a little bit complicated. Okay.